Oh, actually, didn't you ask me to help you look for work? What kind of work were you looking for again? Oh, right. Your old man's craft. How could I forget? Speaking of, how's he doing? Is he feeling any better? Oh, that's good to hear. I have been thinking a lot about him. If I could get some more time off, I'd love to pay him a visit. Actually, while we're talking about him, is he still living in Port Ormos?
Yeah, he's been retired there for a while.
If you could find the time, please write him a letter. Please pass on that recently, faith in the Scarlet King has taken root in Port Ormos and has begun to spread across Sumeru. He has a quick temper, and has always been a devout follower of the Dendro Archon. I don't want him to get into a fight with those Scarlet King believers because of a difference in beliefs.
Oh? So, who are you siding with in all of this? The Academia or the Scarlet King?
I...
I'm so jealous of you. You were born a child of the desert, yet you chose to betray the Scarlet King, and now you spend all your time with those crooks from the Academia.
Akeem? You don't mean you've also become a believer of the Scarlet King?
What's so strange about becoming a believer of the wise Scarlet King? In fact, aren't you the strange one? The one who still can't pick a side?
Can't pick a side? Me?
Whoa! Paimon had no idea you'd be so good at this! You really zeroed in on the issue and put it right in front of her. It might feel a bit overwhelming for Sitaria. But once everything is over, I'll be sure to pay her a visit to her mind and explain everything. Anyway, let's keep going. Come on! Sitaria's already started talking with Shishan!
About the well-being of my retinue during my impromptu absence.
I'm sure the good people of the Adventurers Guild are absolutely fine, mein Fräulein.
So, Shishan, have you noticed anything weird in the city lately? Like, as if someone was trying to preach to you about something?
Oh, right. Speaking of strange things, I celebrated the Sub-Zerus festival so many times that I lost count. That was really weird.
Wait, how could you be aware of that? That should be impossible. Nothing in the report indicated anything like that.
Are you still failing to realize that the Academia's lowly tricks could never deceive all of Sumeru's citizens?
Uh, Jishan, don't tell me that you've converted to the Scarlet King as well!
What an absurd question. You make it sound like I should be ashamed for becoming a believer of the Scarlet King. In reality, shouldn't you be the one who is ashamed? You, who worked side by side with the Academia and treated people as nothing more than experimental subjects?
Please, please stop!
Even now, Satari is still trying to run from her problems. She can no longer justify everything to herself. This is the most important part of all. Quick, get ready.
Mercenary, you're a member of the Corps of 30, correct? Please help me pass a message to the Matra right away. The situation in the city is getting out of control.
Please, try to remain calm, miss. Tell me what's happening in the city.
Heretics are infiltrating the city, and they've already converted many residents to their side.
Heretics? What kind of heresy are you talking about?
The Scarlet King! Many people I know have suddenly started believing in him, but he's long dead. It's impossible.
Miss Zetaria, nothing is impossible.
You know my name?
The Scarlet King is immortal, and all who defy him will one day pay the price. You must face the truth, Zetaria. You tread a treacherous path, and the longer you ignore it, the tighter the Academia's grasp on you will become, and the deeper you will be ensnared. Child of the Scarlet King, never forget that the desert that belongs to you lies elsewhere.
What's so strange about becoming a believer of the wise Scarlet King? In fact, aren't you the strange one? The one who still can't pick a side?
What an absurd question. You make it sound like I should be ashamed for becoming a believer of the Scarlet King.
Zetaria, why haven't you gone home?
It's seems that no matter where I run, I only keep finding more believers of the Scarlet King. I have to say, this is a familiar feeling. I've also been running from my guilt this whole time. Guilt over my part in the Sage's plans, and from ignoring the letters from the children of my homeland. No matter how much I may try to ignore and get rid of it, my guilt always comes back.
You won't necessarily lose your research opportunities by facing the truth. Besides, did you really want to conduct your research while carrying such heavy feelings of guilt?
How do you know me so well? Are you truly just a believer of the Scarlet King, or are you the god himself?
That's not important. The important thing is to pass judgment on the Academia and its sages, and to correct their mistakes. If you could provide some assistance in this matter, perhaps it could serve as a form of atonement.
I've actually never believed in the gods, but I've always believed in serendipity. Your appearance must be a fated opportunity for me to get out of this wretched situation. Please tell me, what can I do for you?
How much do you know about the Sage's current activities?
I was just one of the designers for the Masked Dream Harvest scheme, which is what happened around the Sub-Zeru's festival. But I know very little about the full scope of the overall project. I'd assume that only staff with the highest clearance would have access to those confidential documents. I've just been working to meet the Grand Sage's specified requirements. Previously expelled has returned to the city, and even the sages are still quite wary of him.
To fight against the Academia, we will need to figure out the nature and the purpose of their work. Is there a way for us to get access to the confidential documents you mentioned?
It should be possible if we're willing to take some risks. After all, I'm an assistant to the Grand Sage, and I've been working on many tasks outside of the project. One thing, though, I won't be able to transfer the documents to you through the Akasha once I get my hands on them. The sages have always closely monitored all activities within the Akasha. Let me see. Let's use the most primitive method. Send someone to pick up the documents tomorrow evening at the Academia entrance.
The Academia entrance? Wouldn't that be too conspicuous?
Don't worry about that. I assure you, this won't be a trap. I'm only suggesting this location because it'll draw more scrutiny for me to leave the Academia again. It'll be safest for me to distract the guards long enough to hand you the documents.
All right, I trust you.
Would it mean I've atoned for my wrongdoings?
That'll depend on the judgment of the Dendro Archon.
The Dendro Archon. That's right. Her people are the ones we have endangered. As the God of Wisdom, she's also the one responsible for judging and guiding the scholars. Maybe it's time for me to find a god to believe in.
Just as Nahida predicted, we've managed to bring Sataria to our side! The Traveler's execution was ingenious. She's the one who deserves all the praise. Well, now that we've made plans to meet again tomorrow evening, all we can do is pray for Sataria's mission to go off without a hitch.
Pray? But if we're going to pray to the gods, aren't we just praying to you, God of Wisdom and Guardian of the Scholars?
No. The truth is the true Guardian of Scholars. I've always believed that. Anyway, let's meet again tomorrow evening at the Adventurers Guild.
And founded paradise, for I, Bishop.
Catherine, we're here!
Oh, you are the other Catherine, right?
That's right. I suppose I'm the other Catherine in your mind.
Identity.
Yep, Paimon's right. We cannot fully rule out the chance that the meetup tonight is just a trap. If something were to happen, my existence may be the only trump card we'll be able to play. After all, the Academia should still be unable to confirm the existence of my consciousness in the outside world.
Yep. Exactly. Just what Paimon was thinking. Anyway, enough about that. Let's just make sure to be on our guard. Off? What do you feel is off? It's the middle of the night. Of course it's quiet. You're not getting paranoid, are you?
No, I think she's right. It really is a lot quieter than usual. If you look around, there seems to be fewer people on the streets. I'm not sure if this is the case for the entire city, though.
Huh. Maybe it's just a coincidence. Maybe Sitaria figured out a way to not only distract the guards, but also to get everyone to go to sleep early, just so we can exchange the documents in peace.
I also can't quite figure out why things feel a little off. But now that we're here, let's go ahead and meet her as we planned.
Well, regardless, as long as you're here with us, Paimon feels a little safer. There really aren't many people out right now. Let's hope it'll be this quiet in front of the academia, and that Sitaria managed to distract all the guards.
The triumphant hero returns at last. And to a rather spectacular welcome, even if I do say so myself.
You're the outcast, expelled from the academia.
Indeed I am. Although these days they tend to call me the Doctor. If you're looking for your researcher friend, she has already been taken into confinement. With some basic caution, she could have discovered the listening device on her person. Clearly, she lacks the degree of rigor expected of a true scholar.
The people of Samir City! What have you done to them?
I simply made some minor adjustments to their Akasha terminals. Now they can deposit information directly into the subconscious. As you can see, all these lovely people now believe this traveler is a hero who has just saved the world. My experiment is a success. And now it seems they can no longer hold back their sheer adoration.
No, what should we do? These are all just regular people.
Leave now. You need to get out of here.
But that guy's a Fatui Harbinger! We can't just leave you here!
Nor can I abandon the people of Samaru! Don't worry. We'll meet again outside of the city.
You appear to have overridden their mental faculties with your own consciousness. To possess such a powerful mind, you must be the God of Wisdom.
Needs to catch your breath first. wasn't counting on running into a new Harbinger here, let alone such a high-ranking one. That guy was number two. So scary. He called himself the Doctor. Remember, Tainari told us about him. Satoria did say that someone who once got expelled from the Academia came back recently. And that even the sages are wary of him. Yep, sounds like she must have been talking about the Doctor. Yeah, now that the Doctor's in the picture, we're no longer just dealing with the Academia. They're in cahoots with the Fatui! But what are the Fatui after this time? Another Gnosis? Yeah, things would be a lot easier with Nahida's help. Nahida said we'll meet again outside of the city. But we can't just keep waiting around, right? You mean... Oh, right! Wasn't he invited by the sages to work on some project when we were staying with him in the Vidya Forest? That has to be the same project! Even though he turned it down at the time, he might still know something. There's no time to lose. Let's go to Gundarvaville!
Hold it right there! A blonde-haired traveler and a floating fairy. We've got you, all right. Take a look around. You've fallen right into our trap.
Are you mercenaries from the Corps of 30? Did you come here to arrest us?
Corps of 30? We're nothing like those government lapdogs who don't even get scraps for their work. We are an elite brigade that commands the highest commission rate in all of Sumeru. We're here on the orders of a client known only as the Outcast.
The Outcast? An outcast from the Academia? But why wouldn't the Doctor just send the Fatui after us?
Still wasting time on idle chit-chat. We'll shut you up soon enough. Get them!
You're up, Traveler!
Shadow Raven, let night fall!
Ha! Ha!
retribution!
A new punching bag.
Think you can get away?
It isn't over yet! Here comes reinforcements!
Here we go!
That was pretty rough. Is that what elite mercenaries are like? Yeah, looks like we'll have to keep our guards up. But this doctor guy seems like a pretty tough opponent. He knew exactly where to set up an ambush. Did he predict that we would try to find Tainari? Going up against smart people is tough. Anyway, let's keep going.
Doing back here?
Kale! It's nice to see you again! Are you doing alright?
To be honest, I'm not doing too well. My Elazar has been progressing at a faster rate lately. I'm finding it harder to complete more intricate tasks. As a result, Master Tainari is taking me off the patrol schedule. He will only allow me to stay here and coordinate other people's tasks.
Oh, Kale! Speaking of Tainari, did he go off on patrol? We're here to talk to him!
Oh, Master Tainari? He just left the Ovidia Forest a little while ago. He was headed to Pardis DI. Too. Master Tainari always prioritizes his work as a forest watcher above everything. He almost never leaves his post. He left in a hurry this time, though. No, I only found out that he left through a message he left behind. He also made sure to delegate all his tasks using a schedule. To leave in such a hurry? I'd guess he had something urgent to take care of. Master Tainari originally studied in the Immorta Darshan of the Academia, and Pardis DI is something like the Immorta's research base. Many rare shrubs and grasses have been planted there for research. that before he became a Forest Watcher, Master Tainari once spent a long time conducting research at Pardis DI.
A research base, huh? Gotta wonder what kind of research Tainari just decided to work on all of a sudden. Oh, we don't have a lot of time, so let's go look for him at Pardis DI.
Don't worry. I'm fine. I'm used to living with Elazar by now. If you run into Master Tainari, please send him my regards.
Got it. Will do. See you later, Kale!
I had already made up my mind, to be honest with you. So I didn't try to hide my current condition. Don't worry about me. He'll be fine.
Okay, we were so worried about you. Hey, this was supposed to be a touching reunion, but you're ruining the moment. Actually, it's very smart of the Traveler to be wary of me right now. After all, the Doctor has shown that his technology can apparently even control human minds. Plus, it's not like you could have known what happened after we split up and I was facing the Doctor by myself. Even a pool of stagnant water after a torrential storm can occasionally pass as a patch of sky.
Paimon feels like only the real Nahida could come up with such an obscure analogy.
Huh? But I wasn't trying to win your trust or anything. All I wanted was to clarify my point.
Well, we understand that point now. Please, Nahida, tell us more about what happened. Are those poor people all right?
When you left, I was still in the middle of restoring everyone's minds. Thankfully, when the Doctor mentioned depositing information into the subconscious, he didn't mean engraving information into their minds. Instead, he did something closer to creating hallucinations that was still within my power to fix. Luckily, I managed to finish my restorations and mind jump away from him just as he was about to capture me.
Whew. sigh of relief. The doctor sure pulled out some hidden cards, but good thing we had Nahida with us.
I wouldn't be relieved just yet. I gave away my true identity when I restored everyone's minds, which means we've lost another one of our trump cards. Also, the doctor is already an expert at modifying Akasha terminals. Maybe it's only a matter of time until he captures my consciousness inside the Akasha.
Would that mean you'd no longer be able to jump between minds? Then how do we stop him? He's still at the Academia, so it's possible he already started messing with the Akasha. Ugh, it feels like he's toying with us. What a nasty piece of work. Plus, the doctor's combat ability alone is apparently enough to make him worthy of being number two of the Fatui.
We shouldn't give up hope just yet. Let's try to find another way to attack this problem.
Actually, Nahida, how did you know we were trying to get to Party's DI? Have you been waiting for us?
Yes, I have. I can see the Traveler's elemental energy, so I deduced your destination by looking at the direction you were moving in. You didn't come here for sightseeing, right? Did you find any leads?
We're looking for a scholar we know. His name is Tainari, and the sages once tried to reach out to him. Why don't you come inside with us and see what we can find?
Okay. Let's just hope we won't get him into trouble.
Have you considered the possibility that there's something wrong with her?
Traveler?
It is you!
Ah! The voice! It's Hypatia!
Ah, what a pleasant surprise! It's so nice to see the two of you again.
Who's this?
She's a scholar we met in the Avidia Forest! When we last saw each other, she was still training in the... what's it called? Satyavada Life?
Oh, I see.
That's right, we're old friends. You've come at just the right time. Ever since I've come here, hardly anyone has even talked to me.
Hypatia, you're way too excited about this. Actually, for you to leave the Avidia Forest means... You're not in training anymore? Wait, no. Did you already finish your training and reach Pariporna Life?
What do you think? My consciousness has already managed to make contact with the Divine.
You did it? Congratulations!
It's so exhilarating to share this sublime joy with others at long last! When my consciousness made contact with the gods, ah, what a supreme and unparalleled experience that was! Alright. Actually, please wait. I haven't forgotten my promise to you. Remember? I promised to help you understand what you saw from Irminsul once I gained deeper insights. My current self has not only gained true insight, but I can even help you establish a direct connection to the consciousness of the divine.
You can do that?
I've never heard of anything like that, but if you want to give it a try, I'll do my best to protect your consciousness during the process.
Hold on. I brought some spirit borne ale with me. This is still a crucial part of the ceremony.
We're using that incense again?
All right now. Hold my hand. I'll help you establish a pathway to connect your consciousness.
Okay.
Ready?
It took 3 betrayals for me to finally understand. The world is just an elaborate tapestry of lies. My fury will never be quelled. The first to betray me was a god, my creator, my mother. Valuing strength above all, she saw no worth in me and I was discarded. The second was a human. My family. My friend. Consumed by fear, he saw me as an abomination. The third was one exactly like me. A hope for the future. A fledgling barely out of the nest. Powerless before his mortality, he broke his promise to me. Humans, they can't be trusted. And the gods fill me with pure loathing. So I said good riddance. I denounce the world and laugh in its face. My chest will never again be defiled by worldly filth. I will scrub away every last trace of human emotion. Then it will be empty, a blank slate, and ready to receive a supreme gnosis, brimming with pure divinity. There is no need to fear. The pain will be brief. Your era is coming to an end.
What was that? Did we actually just see the Balladeer's memories? Everything matches what we know about him. The divine consciousness that Hypatia was talking about.
You saw it, right? You felt it, right? Such a majestic god! Such a noble will! Such sublime emotion! Alas, shame. If only that which beats within my chest wasn't a filthy mortal heart. Oh, great and merciful God, please grant me forgiveness and salvation.
Do you understand now? I'm afraid this is no periportal life, but rather...
Ah! You, why are you so mean to me? Why is everyone hiding from me?
profound divine wisdom. Shouldn't I receive praise and honor? Haven't I uncovered that light in the darkness?
Apasia?
That's how I always thought everything should be. Wait. Have I already lost my mind?
Wait, something isn't right!
Oh, the Traveler's back?
Nahida was controlling your body for a while. It seemed like she jumped over to you as an emergency measure right before the Catherine puppet was destroyed. And came over. He helped us defeat the mercenaries and then he ran with us all the way here. What? You swapped places? You mean your consciousness also went into Nahida's body? Wait, then where is Nahida's consciousness? Where is she now?
I never imagined that an individual's consciousness could be transferred around like this. Had I not seen it with my own eyes, I would have never believed it. I don't think this can be achieved with current human technology. Also, while we were running, the consciousness in your body told me to pass on a message. She said... The doctor has found a way to trap my consciousness, so I can't journey with you anymore. But even in a moonless night, a shower of starlight can still drown out illusions and lies.
Trapped in the sanctuary of Sarasthana for good this time! Was that message all she left for us? It's pretty vague. Oh, that makes sense! Since the doctor captured her, she won't be able to say anything without him knowing! She's being extra careful. Even in a moonless night, a shower of starlight can still drown out illusions and lies. Huh. Paimon knows the moon illusions and lies are from that alchemical divination at the Sub-Zeru's festival. Didn't Nahida use a starlight analogy before? It had something to do with Sitaria. Out of sense. Huh. Do you think Nahida was telling us to go find help in the desert? But she isn't with us anymore. Think we'll be okay?
Paimon, you said Sanctuary of Sarasthana. Does this mean that this Nahida you're talking about, the consciousness who was occupying the Traveler's body, is the Dendro Archon?
Your guess is correct, but the situation's a bit complicated, so it's really hard for us to explain right now.
That's all right. A scholar's curiosity doesn't need to be appeased right away. As for the complicated nature of the situation, safe to say I have witnessed that for myself. I've spent some time with you, and it looks like the Dendro Archon's also on your side, so I trust you.
Thank you, Tainari! Oh, actually, we came here to ask you a question. What do you know about the project that the sages have been working on?
Ah, that. While I was indeed invited to join that project, the sages were always secretive about its scope and goals, so I eventually declined. All I know is that that project has something to do with the restoration of Ermansoul.
Huh? Did you see something when you were in Nahida's body? What?
Do you have any evidence? So that's what happened. That explains why Hypatia's symptoms were different from those of the other scholars who went mad. It's because she made contact with the consciousness of a new god who is still in the process of being born.
Tainari, did you leave the Avidia Forest because of Hypatia?
I did. I noticed Hypatia's mental anomalies. But since her symptoms were rather atypical, I secretly took her to Pardis Dii and began searching for a way to return her to her normal self. If I didn't take action, Hypatia would have already been taken by the Matra to the desert, doomed to a life of exile at Aru Village. Now that you mention it, I knew the Academia has never thought particularly highly of Lesser Lord Kusanali, but I still didn't expect them to do something as arrogant as creating a new god. Looks like I made the right decision by not accepting their invitation. The Doctor and the Balladeer. We have two Fatui Harbingers in Sumeru. Sounds like we're in for a bad time. From your description, I don't think they've completed their project. There may still be room for us to intervene. But then, what is the connection between creating a new god and restoring Ermine's soul?
Yeah, it feels like we're still nowhere close to figuring out the sage's goals. Right, we've pretty much gone over everything we need to know, so we should head out. How about you, Tainari? What are you going to do?
I'll stay here for now. I still want to try a few more things to help Hypatia. If you're planning to go into the desert, start by heading for Caravan Rabat. That'll be your fastest route. Come find me here if there's anything else I can do to help. May the Spirit of Wisdom go with you.
We're off then!
Hear the voice of fate, speaking my name in hum. Supplication.
Here. just past this wall is the desert, huh? Oh, wow. Paimon remembers hearing people call this the Wall of Samiel. It's made to block sandstorms from the outside. Oh, if it's this tall, it's gotta be the divine work of Greater Lord Rukadevata, right?
Enough gawking. Come on, follow me.
Huh?
Over here.
Oh, Hathan went that way! Let's hurry up and follow him. Wonder what he's up to.
Where did she go? How did we lose them? They were just here a second ago.
More Aramite mercenaries? Who are they working for this time? Anyway, Traveler, it seems like we were being followed again.
You were too careless. You should have noticed those hopeless amateurs trailing you a long time ago. There's no need to thank me. I've never cared to keep track of personal favors. All I did was correct a mistake I happened to come across. It's a habit I developed at the academia.
You really gave Paimon a scare, Alhatham! We never thought we'd run into you here! Last time we met at Port Ormos, didn't you say you were going back to the academia?
Wait! Don't tell Paimon that you're here to take us back on their orders!
Oh, so you've already landed yourselves on the academia's hit list. I can't say that I didn't expect it. However, had I wished to turn you over to the academia, don't you think you'd already be the Eremite's honored guests by now?
Oh, right. You do have a point.
I have no interest in running errands for that project. As a scholar, I've always belonged to the camp that promotes researcher autonomy. And these days, you're more fascinating than anything the sages can offer. Not quite. To tell you the truth, I'm still investigating the Divine Knowledge Capsule. Unfortunately, I've run into some difficulties. Everyone says the capsule originated in the desert and was eventually moved to Port Ormos. If I am to get to the bottom of this, I must understand how the capsule first came to be. Which brings me back to you, and why you're so interesting. The leader of Ain al-Ahmar used the Divine Knowledge Capsule right in front of you, and upon seeing him, your expression became perplexed, and you were lost in thought for quite some time. To have that kind of reaction, I think you must have realized something. Are you interested at all in sharing what you've been hiding from me?
Alhatham, you really have a ridiculous eye for detail. What kind of person even notices or remembers stuff like that?
So that's your answer. Well, I do work for the academia after all. So considering that, it is indeed wise to keep your cards close to your chest. But that does prove you do have some undisclosed information about the Divine Knowledge Capsule. Am I right? No matter. Rather than simply learning the answers from you, I'd still prefer to investigate on my own. Speaking of, you two are also headed to the desert?
That's right! We have the same plan as you! But we don't really have any concrete goals at the moment.
Then I'd suggest starting with Aru Village. It's the largest settlement in the desert, so it'll probably have more resources and intel than anywhere else. Well, would you like to head there together?
It's always better to travel with someone you know. Let's go!
Our Savial defenses must be maintained at all times.
Thank you.
Yahoo!
Ha! Ha!
Trinkets lie veiled within this desolate plain.
Like a lamb to the slaughter.
Adventure time! Get out of here!
As you wish, main Fräulein.
Illustrious name. Has brought me hither.
Before us lies Aru Village, the safe haven of the desert folk.
Whoa, this landscape is really something else. What a cool place! Let's go check it out!
Unless my memory fails me, we have barely spoken two words to each other before now at the Academia. Would you care to enlighten me as to when and how I invited the General Mahamacha's wrath?
Oh, Haytham, do not think you can escape my judgment just because you managed to escape my attack.
Judgment? So that's how you'd characterize your actions here, is it? Or would elimination perhaps be a more accurate description?
Had I used my full strength, not even this traveler would have been able to stop me. Though styled like an assassination, I sought only to ensure that my target would be unable to flee or resist. Standard practice for the Matra, as well you know.
Seemed to me more like your own personal touch.
Who is that, Al-Haytham? Did you call him General Mahamatra?
Yes. General Mahamatra Sino. Head of all the Matra at the Academia. He's a formidable hunter, and the ultimate nightmare for any who have committed academic crimes.
You seem to have placed a lot of trust in Al-Haytham, to the point of blocking an attack for him. If I were you, I'd never choose to side with him. I wouldn't believe a single word that comes out of his mouth. I have been pursuing this scribe for a long time. I urge you, stand back and do not seek to defend him any longer. Otherwise, there will be consequences.
Has Al-Haytham done something wrong? Hyman doesn't think he's as bad as you've made him out to be.
I won't waste my breath explaining things. Al-Haytham. I saw it during our fight. Take it out. The divine knowledge capsule you're hiding on your person. Unless you want me to retrieve it for myself.
Very perceptive of you. Nothing escapes a Matra's senses.
Wait! The divine knowledge capsule? Didn't it fall into the Matra's hands in Port Ormos?
No wonder you speak with such confidence, Sino. But I must admit, I'm very curious. What does this capsule mean to you? And why, as General Mahamatra of the Academia, are you all alone in the desert? As far as I'm aware, the other Matra have been speculating about your disappearance. Have you been given a mission that's, let's say, morally dubious? If I was the real target of your mission, what was stopping you from simply using your authority and resources to judge me within the walls of the Academia?
I should have known you'd be difficult to deal with.
You two! Ugh. What should we do, Traveler? Paimon feels like we can't trust either of them!
Well, look at you two, acting all tough and self-righteous over there.
Wait, Dia? Great! Finally, someone that we can trust! You gotta help us out here, otherwise these two are gonna start fighting again!
Yeah, sure looks that way. Two giants from the Academia duking it out once and for all. Not something you get to see every day, that's for sure. Listen, I know you academic types love to fill up your big brains with self-righteous morality and lord your empty rules and virtues over each other. But how dare you bring your petty disputes into the safe haven of Aru Village? It seems like someone's gonna have to beat some sense into your thick skulls until you finally learn to respect these grounds. Hey, did either of you hear a word I just said? Another sandstorm? What's up with these recently?
Hey! All of you, over here, quickly! We have to take cover!
Someone's calling for us! Oh, this wind is too strong! Let's get over there!
That sounded like Candace. Come on, you two! Jeez, are all of you Academia folks such hard work? Move it!
All right, stop yelling.
Awkward. Hey, wanna play sardines with three people who wanna tear each other limb from limb? Sure, why not? Sounds fun. The air is so thick and heavy. Paimon can hardly keep floating anymore.
My sincere apologies, everyone. This is the home of our village chief. I will have to ask you to make do with this small room until the sandstorm dies down. Please, let me introduce myself. I am Candace, protector of Aru Village.
Our savior has come at last! Nice to meet you, Candace. The name's Paimon. Thank you so much for helping us.
There's no need to thank me. It's only right to help each other when the weather gets rough.
Wow, she's so gentle and caring, like a nice older sister. Unlike those guys over there.
All right, now that we're all better acquainted, we should return to the topic at hand. As a guardian charged with the responsibility to protect my fellow villagers from harm, I was observing your conflict from afar, even before the sandstorm started. And now that you have set foot within Aru Village itself, it is all the more my responsibility to make absolutely sure that you pose no threat whatsoever to us. So please, have an honest and sincere conversation with one another, and put your hostile feelings to rest. If anyone dares to start anything again while they are under this roof, I will not hesitate to send them out for some quality time with the creatures of the sandstorm.
Second thought, Paimon may have misjudged Candace's character.
And that goes for you too, Miss Dia. Do I make myself clear?
All right, we got it, Candace.
That's what I like to hear. So, which of you will begin?
I was supposed to be a mediator, but I might have gotten a little too involved just now. Anyway, one of those two should probably start talking.
Wait, that was you trying to be a mediator?
I have nothing to hide. So there's no shame in explaining myself. While Alhatham wasn't wrong about the other Matra not knowing my whereabouts, it's not because I've been assigned a morally dubious mission. Rather, I've chosen to exile myself.
Huh? Exile yourself?
A little while ago, I discovered that there was data missing in the Academia's project planning and development files. What little they did report clearly did not match the project's actual progress. As General Mahamatra, I had the responsibility and authority to request an audit. However, to my surprise, the person responsible for the erroneous data was none other than Grand Sage Azar himself. I tried to investigate the issue myself before submitting a formal audit request, but I soon found that all leads and potential pieces of incriminating evidence were carefully concealed from me. I began to realize that they were cautious of me from the very beginning. Unsurprisingly, the Grand Sage rejected my audit request as soon as the submission reached his desk. He even said to me The power of the General Mahamatra is granted by the sages. You have no right to judge us.
So they really are up to no good.
I realized then that to the Grand Sage, the Matra are nothing more than tools for the sages to assert and maintain their control over knowledge. The vows that we took, the principles that we strive to uphold, they are meaningless to the academia of today. I believed it would be wise to flee the academia before the sages had a chance to take action against me. This way, they can no longer see nor predict my actions. I will never give up on this investigation. There's no need for someone else to give me power or authority. Once I find the truth, I will administer judgment by my own name.
Seems to have the same goal as us. We're all investigating the sages.
Now that he's no longer the General Mahamatra, he somehow feels a lot less scary. Well, Sino, if that's your story, then why did you see Alhatham as a target?
When I was investigating the matter in the academia, I overheard a conversation between Al-Haytham and a sage. The sages asked you to investigate a blonde-haired traveler. Do you dispute this, Al-Haytham?
What?
Like many parts of the project, this assignment was undocumented. Now throw in your suspicious behavior with the Divine Knowledge Capsule, and I think we deserve an explanation.
Yes. I was indeed tasked with investigating the Traveler.
Al-Haytham!
After all, the promised reward was so great that hardly any scholar could have refused. The sage told me, once you've completed this assignment, I can give you a glimpse of divine knowledge.
A most enticing offer.
Unfortunately, those academics don't know me at all. Their words contained one key piece of information, namely that divine knowledge indeed exists. That gave me all I needed to know. From my perspective, the sages are far from trustworthy. Think about it. Isn't it a little strange they're so willing to share divine knowledge with anyone, even as a reward? So, I began my own investigation following the lead of the Divine Knowledge Capsule. In the end, I realized my wisdom in committing to this rather than collaborating with the sages. Had I been less guarded, I probably would have ended up like that Ain al-Ahmar mercenary, incapable of remaining sane for long enough to hold a conversation.
You mean that the sages originally planned to dispose of you using one of those capsules that drive people insane?
I'd already given up on the assignment by then. I only told the academia I was waiting in Port Ormos for you to appear so they wouldn't suspect anything. So it came as quite a surprise when I encountered my erstwhile target while investigating the Divine Knowledge Capsule.
Criminals do love to talk about coincidences.
Even though I ran into the Traveler by chance, I had no intention of providing assistance to the academia. Also, you should remember, you were the ones who decided to follow me and strike up a conversation after I left that tavern.
That's true. Al-Haytham helped us out at Caravan Rebot as well. Maybe he's telling the truth.
I'm willing to apologize, if that's worth anything to you. I took the Divine Knowledge Capsule behind your back because I judged its existence to be a significant risk. I felt that it would be best for no one to interact with it before it had been properly studied. After all, curiosity often proves to be the most dangerous thing in this land.
You should be well aware, Scribe Al-Haytham, that curiosity can also lead you to danger and suspicion. Answer me this. Did the sages share any information about their project with you?
Have I not made myself clear? You and I are both distrusted by the academia. Do you really think they would tell me anything?
Fine. Although you haven't completely proven your innocence, I won't regard you as an enemy, for now.
As you wish.
Mm-hmm. Good. I'm glad to see you two clearing up your misunderstandings. And now you, Dia. I believe it's your turn.
Oh, sorry. Whatever the boys were talking about must have been so boring that I spaced out. My situation is pretty straightforward. My employer, Dunyarzad of the Homayani family, is friends with the Traveler and is currently recovering from her illness at home. I had nothing going on, so I decided to return to our village for a visit. I was actually looking forward to a pretty exciting time getting back together with everyone here. But then I saw these two random guys in the middle of a pointless argument. You take me off, and things went downhill from there.
Is that all? Well, I will admit that definitely sounds like your style. In that case, welcome back, dear.
That's more like it. I missed you all so much, Candace.
Whoa! What was that sound?
No need to worry. Now that you're no longer at each other's throats, please make yourselves at home. I'll take a quick trip outside to clear out some of those creatures in the sandstorm.
Creatures? In the sandstorm? Are you sure you don't want some backup?
Fighting in a sandstorm is not for the faint-hearted. Anyone without extensive training in these conditions is at a disadvantage. You needn't worry.
Yeah, just leave them to Candace. Don't worry, she's as tough as they come.
The winds died down. That means the sandstorm's over, right? Candace still isn't back yet, though. Is she all right? Maybe we should go out and check on her.
When you put it that way, even I'm starting to feel a little worried. All right, let's go. We've been here long enough, and the boys are as chatty as the floor.
Yes. They just keep coming in waves. I've lost count of how many I've defeated. Before I realized it, even the sandstorm had stopped.
Ah! You're
Leave this round to us. I got interrupted earlier, but now I have something to take my anger out on.
It's been quite a while since I've seen the Flame Mane in action. I'll leave these to you then.
I'll be sure to put on a good show. Let's go!
By royal decree!
Yahoo! Yahoo! Yeah!
I'm going in!
Ha! Ha! Ha!
Here comes another wave! When are they ever gonna let up?
Brace yourselves! Think you can get away? Here we go! Yeah! Odd reveal!
The creature stopped appearing. Was that the last of them?
What we fought just now was probably the aftermath of the sandstorm. So we should be safe for the time being.
Well fought, everyone. No injuries, I hope.
Huh? Who are you?
Ah, my apologies. I haven't had a chance to greet you yet. I had my hands full taking care of the village's elderly and children. I am the chief of Aru Village. Everyone usually calls me Uncle Anpu.
Sir, I am also originally from the desert, but I have not been back for some time now. May I ask if such sandstorms are common?
I can't say they've always been common, but recently the storms have become increasingly severe and frequent. Besides sandstorms, we also occasionally get earthquakes. According to an investigator who stayed in the village a while ago, these unusual natural phenomena are related to the withering of Erminsul.
Another effect of Erminsul's withering. So, Erminsul's withering causes withering zones in the forest and sandstorms and earthquakes here in the desert?
Everything in the natural world is inextricably connected to Erminsul. These regional symptoms can indeed be a reflection of Erminsul's present state.
Everyone in Aru Village needs to take good care of themselves. Speaking of which, why haven't I seen a single village keeper since I got here?
Village keeper? Who are they? Village guards like Candace?
Does your curiosity know no bounds? Village keeper is how Aru Village refers to mad scholars exiled here by the academia. Most of them are scholars who lost their sanity after a period of training in the Avidia Forest. The academia believes that their crazed mutterings may have a negative effect on the psyches of other scholars. So, they're forcibly exiled to the desert. Though if you ask me, it's all a boatload of nonsense.
Alas, that's exactly what we've been trying to investigate. One by one, the village keepers have been mysteriously disappearing without a trace. But no one in the village has ever seen them leave. If you're planning to stay around the village for the next few days, I'd appreciate it if you could keep an eye out for them.
I've had encounters with those people in the past. I'll see what I can do to help.
The Matra are the ones responsible for their exile. Now that you're no longer with them, are you trying to alleviate your guilt and atone for your past sins? I'm fascinated by how you think.
Mock me if you will, but if you are guilty, I will eliminate you, regardless of my position or identity.
Oh, you're the former General Mahamatra. You must be an expert in these kinds of investigations. Thank you for your help.
Is it because you're reminded of Hypatia? Oh, these poor scholars. First they lose their sanity, now this! We need to help get them back home, safe and sound. But, is it really a good idea to tag along with Sino? You seem like you really don't trust him.
I'll be grateful for the assistance. No doubt you will do a better job than some of my former subordinates. Let's start by finding a spot to share what we know so far. Although I've sent myself into exile, I'm still doing essentially the same things as before. Do you still have any questions for me before we start our investigation? One of my former subordinates told me that this title has its origins in a strange incident. The Academia has long exiled mad scholars to Aru Village. A mysterious phenomenon exists here. When mad scholars first arrive, they are as incoherent and deranged as before. But after spending some time here, they invariably begin to calm down. Initially, the people of Aru Village greatly resented having to take in the mad scholars. But a strange incident one night changed that. Aru Village was struck by the strongest earthquake in living memory. Seeing buildings on the verge of collapse all around him, the then chief of the village was preparing to take everyone to safety. Suddenly, he noticed a mad scholar crouching in a corner, caressing the ground with his hands. A soft, green light radiated from him, like a divine glow against the backdrop of night. Despite the powerful tremors that ripped through the ground that night, all the houses remained upright, almost as if they had grown roots reaching deep into the ground. In the end, not a single building collapsed, and no one was hurt. After that, the people of Aru Village treated the mad scholars with greater kindness and began to refer to them as the village keepers.
The soft green light? A mad scholar protecting Aru Village? What do you make of it, Traveler? Paimon thinks so too. Actually, Sino, Do you know if any of the Mad Scholars continued to wear their Akasha terminals at Aru Village?
In theory, they would continue wearing them so the Academia could still monitor their activities. With that said, the main Akasha system would no longer have any interaction with them.
Oh, no wonder! Everything makes sense then! Add in the fact that they calmed down, it was probably Nahida who calmed them.
If you are able to draw a conclusion from this one story alone, then it appears you possess much more information than I do. So, what do you make of the story? Really? Lesser Lord Kusanami.
What? You don't believe us? Lesser Lord Kusanami was definitely using the Akasha to give her power to the Mad Scholars!
No, it's not so much that I don't believe you. I'm just struck by your reasoning. Lesser Lord Kusanami, the current Dendro Archon, is she really active in Sumeru? The Academia has always placed far greater importance on the late Greater Lord Rukadevata. They've more or less ignored Lesser Lord Kusanami, and I've never had any reason to doubt their views. In addition, I've never heard any stories about Lesser Lord Kusanami and her deeds. To me, she might as well have been a god that never existed.
No way! Nahida definitely exists! She's a... How should Paimon put it? She's a good Archon who's kind and wise, even if she says weird stuff sometimes.
I've spent many years interrogating criminals, so I can easily tell when someone is lying.
Good! Then you should know that we're telling the truth!
That look in your eyes... I've never seen that from a liar. You two really must have met Lesser Lord Kusanami. How can this be? To think, our Archon has been amongst us this entire time.
Alright, now it's our turn to put our skills to good use for this investigation. But easier said than done, especially since we don't have any leads. Maybe we can start by knocking on some doors.
Excuse me, are you here to help me find my grandpa?
Huh? Who are you?
By the sounds of it, a resident of this village.
My name is Isak. You'll help me find my grandpa, right?
Is your grandpa a mad scholar?
Hey, don't say that. Grandpa is just grandpa. Why do you have to call him that? It's not like he's a bad person or anything.
The person you're referring to is not a local. Yet you are. Why do you call him Grandpa?
Grandpa is just Grandpa. He's my family. I heard everything you said to the village chief. Please, you gotta take me with you. I wanna find my grandpa. I swear I'll help. I won't be a nuisance.
Ah, so you're the one who was eavesdropping on us around the village chief's house. I was planning to go out and take care of whoever it was, but I had a vague feeling that they didn't harbor any ill intent.
Whoa. Ethan wasn't kidding about Matra having sharp senses. Sino, he's just a kid. All he wants is to find his grandpa. Let's find a way to help him.
Sorry, I was only listening in because I wanted to know where Grandpa went. Honest, if you don't believe me, you can ask Miss Candace.
All right. But first, let's confirm the facts with Candace.
is super vigilant. Is this what all the Matra are like?
Ah, you're back already.
We just wanted to confirm something with you. Do you know a boy by the name of Isak?
I had a feeling he'd go looking for you.
Huh? You knew this would happen?
Yes. Although he tried his best to stay hidden, I still noticed him eavesdropping outside the window. He really wants to get his grandfather back. Isak's parents were both Eremite mercenaries who rarely returned to the village after finding employment in the city. He was raised by his grandfather. Unfortunately, it was only a few years before his grandpa passed away. Isak was still very young at the time, so various families in the village took turns caring for him so he could survive. Later, an elderly mad scholar arrived at the village. Isak thought the scholar bore a striking resemblance to his grandfather, and thus often spied on the man. However, the scholar was unkempt in appearance and incoherent in speech. Although Isak referred to the man as his grandpa, he was afraid and didn't dare to approach him. One summer night, the oft-mumbling and bumbling grandpa suddenly calmed down and seemed to become more lucid. He even noticed Isak hiding in the distance. So Grandpa walked up to Isak and patted him on the head. He even took Isak to the entrance of the village, where he patiently taught the boy the names of the stars and accompanied Isak until he fell asleep. The next morning, Isak woke up and wanted to go find his grandpa again, only to realize his grandpa no longer recognized him. However, even so, Grandpa retained his calm expression. It's said that those who saw the scholar claimed he no longer appeared to be crazy, but appeared to be living in his own world, almost as if he were sleepwalking. Isak was thrilled that his grandpa was able to find peace and would follow him all the time, asking him things like, "Grandpa, want me to take you somewhere fun?" Or, "Grandpa, could you tell me stories about the stars again?"
All this somehow just makes Paimon feel really sad. It seems like they both deserve so much better.
Perhaps. Nearly everyone who lives in the desert has some form of hardship or regret. But even so, we must still continue on with our lives. It's also my reason for fighting. I must continue to protect this land.
Maybe the people have always had a considerate god watching over them.
Huh? What did you say, Zino?
No, nothing. As long as Isak keeps his word and doesn't get in our way, we can take him along.
Perhaps you are more compassionate than I gave you credit for. Please accept my thanks on Isak's behalf, Sino.
Hey, Isak!
Oh, it's you guys!
We've cleared everything up! Let's go find your grandpa!
Really? Wow! Thank you so much!
All right. Let's ask the local residents some questions first.
Okay.